Yeah, you rarely see scripts from James. So, you know, when we got it, it was amazing. You know, just reading it all come on a page, he gives you the visual. It's so clear when he describes, you know, the thoughts and the things that he's trying to execute. As I already saw the vision, you know, just from him explaining it and, you know, how animated it was. You know, obviously we're going to talk about Westerns and the genre of Western because that's the setting. But the fascinating thing to me is how complex each of the characters are. You know, each one of them has a full set of complexities that come with them in gray areas that you don't know, you know, am I rooting for this person or not? Is this person mm-hmm. a victim? And then you realize, yeah, they're all victims some kind mm-hmm. of way. They became heroes out of their victimhood, you know, so you root for them in that way.
And that's how James and I connected, really, was from the script. And when he sent the script, it was a lot of ideas in it. And then I called James, and I have a lot of ideas, James. And I was like, not to be disrespectful, I want to tell you, I really like the script, but this is what I think, and this is, and I was probably talking for a half hour. Mm-hmm. And that's tough to do with James.
You know, it's rare you meet or speak the same kind of language you do mm-hmm. creatively. It's really it's a rare thing. So when you find one of those people, you know, you cherish it. Incidentally, all of us also have a history in music. For me, music and film kind of go hand in hand. So working with James Lassiter, as well as my already existing relationship with Jay-Z, was just a natural progression. I was pretty fortunate with the cast, like the people we wanted. We kind of, you know, we got, there wasn't really, I mean, Idris was pretty much always involved. Me and Idris go back 15 years, so there was no really version of the script where Idris Elba wasn't in it. And Jonathan, I hadn't seen Last Black Man in San Francisco when I cast him, and I wanted him for the role of Nat Love. I'd seen an interview of his. I hadn't seen anything he was in. He was doing an interview for White Boy Rick, and he was just talking about his approach to that particular character, and he was also talking about him helping a younger actor on the film, and just the way he was talking, I was like, that's Nat Love. That's the mental workings of Nat Love, and I could see why he would lead a group into such horrific circumstances, and they'll follow him. And I was hooked on Jonathan Majors from then. And I showed Judith the interview. I'll never forget. I showed Judith the interview, because when I first told you, he was like, you watched the interview, that's Nat Love. That's Nat Love. And pretty much the same thing with Jay. Jonathan was cast without an audition or me having seen any of his work. I just knew he was Nat Love.
And Jonathan, I remember you telling me about Jonathan early on. He was like, this guy's going to be, it was your vision on Jonathan.
Yeah.
I guess you just seeing him and hearing him speak. You know, so sometimes it's big names and, you know, people we know are amazing. And sometimes it's just, again, like, you know, James' vision of seeing something and knowing. And you having that cast and then, you know, COVID hitting and, you know, having all those personalities, and you know, that's just a credit to James and JL with, you know, getting this done. Like, you know, you don't realize the difficulty it takes to pull all this together at a time like that. You know, it takes like special personalities and people with like real passion and really care about the craft and care about people. And
and for me, like, I always wanted Regina, so with me, I go for the best case scenario. Best case scenario for the character of Trudy Smith is Regina King. When I FaceTime people, or if a FaceTime is arranged with me and another actor, I kind of take pleasure or glee in them not knowing how I am as a person. So they all hear like, okay, he's a writer, director, and he's FaceTiming you. And I know what comes on the other end of that FaceTime when they meet me is not what they're expecting. So it's almost like you got 10 seconds to hook whoever it is you're talking to. So I'll kind of like face and wait for it to ring, and then Regina King comes on screen. I'm like, peace to the Black Queen, Regina King. What's cracking? That's exactly what I was saying. Okay. And then from there, I'm already in animated mode and explaining. And you know, really we were fortunate with casting that, the people that we
And that's it's a powerful 1-2 punch because James gives them that, and then, you know, they're intrigued. There's a lean forward, and then it's Jay with the clothes.
We got it done. Very fortunate and very happy with, you know, the cast and how everything turned out.
Because Jim Beckwith was always a hard character to cast.
Yes.
Like, I was searching literally all over the world for the right Jim Beckwith. I wanted like the same kind of warm feeling I get from watching Eddie Murphy in Trading Places when he's in jail, talking to those guys. The same kind of feeling you have in 48 Hours. I hate rednecks in the scene. That's the same kind of thing. So it was really hard finding that person. And during COVID,
right.
RJ was What COVID did was give us a lockdown, and RJ had even more time to work on his gunplay and his roller skates, and he never let those things go. It's hard for me to relate to, because I wrote these characters, right? So they're all a side of me, right? Even Trudy Smith and Stagecoach Mary, you know, she comes on singing, "What? Get that? Oh, send away." It's all kind of sides of, they're all kind of sides of me. But I suppose if I related to a character the most, it would probably be Pickett, because he's a sharpshooter, right? He ain't getting up close and personal. And he let all these guys figure out their gunfighting melee. And he'll stay safe in the distance. I remember one time I went paintball shooting, and I was just a sniper. I said, I never got caught once. I stuck back like a good old-fashioned coward. First coward, and then I'm doing some snitching. So probably it'll be Pickett. Obviously, I'd like to say something like Nat Love.
Yeah, everybody would say Nat Love, right?
I'm going to say Nat Love. But it's not a personal connection to Nat. I think just Nat, in my mind, is the most layered and most complex character in the movie. Because when I read it, I said to James, I said, you know, on a page, kind of just, it reads like a revenge story. And I said, it wasn't that for me, it was a love story. But it was a story about unrequited love, because here was a guy that was on a journey, for one thing, on the surface, but really all he wanted to do was be loved and to love. But before he could get to that point, and this is what I really love about Nat, before he could get to that point, he needed to get whole. And the only way to get whole, and I said this to James, this guy had a hole in his heart. He had such a severe trauma that he couldn't love anybody or be loved until he filled up that hole. And the whole journey of the movie is him just filling that hole so he could be with Mary. And I said, that's like when I watch the movie, that's what I'm watching the whole time. That's why I'm rooting for Nat. Not just because it's a gang versus a gang. It's like, can this guy, which, you know, all of us kind of deal with, can he overcome his trauma? And that's the movie that I saw when I read it. And that's what I really talked to these guys about. It's about Nat Love trauma.
So you relate more to Nat?
No, I relate. I like his journey the most. Uh-huh. I don't know if I relate to
it. Yeah. I think it's pieces of you know, you relate to different pieces of all the characters. That's what I'm saying about it earlier, about how complex and beautiful these characters are, that you can find yourself in a bit of all of them. You know, we don't get into it, but the reason why Cuffy is so skilled at what she does is because she has an eye for tails. She can tell when you're about to do something, like almost like a poker player. Right, everyone has a tail when they're gonna pull. You know, whether you blink your eye or you move your shoulder, something's gonna give away that you're about to thing, and it's gonna give you just enough of an advantage at that second that you can pull your gun quicker. right? So she has that, and then like he said, you know, Nat Love has to fill that void inside him. I personally went through that. Like I had to reconnect with my father before I could move forward in any relationship. And Rufus Buck, the whole time you think he's like the devil, the super villain, but placed in these circumstances, I can relate to that because I'm from Marcy Project. So placed in these circumstances, given these certain set of situations, what are you willing to do for your family? So I can relate to Rufus' struggle, right? As mean and, you know, villainous as he appeared on the outside, you know, when you get his full story, you're like, man, I don't know. I think that for me, you know, I saw a comment that said, you know, when the trailer came out, it's like, it's always comical seeing, like, black people in Westerns. That's how far it's gone. Like, it's comical. Like, it's almost, it's like satire. It's like, no. This is actually true, and you know, and we existed in that time. So anytime you can be a part of redefining that and then like giving voice to, you know, the voiceless and, you know, as well as entertaining, you know, it's always a plus. And so I was super proud of that moment, super proud of how strong the characters was, you know, women in general who, you know, people would have you believe didn't have a voice. They were entrepreneurs and had their own booming businesses and super gangster. And even for like the Asian community, they would have you believe that it was like, you know, in servitude of, you know, a certain privilege when, you know, they actually, you know, owned them. Like they were entrepreneurs as well. So. To get to redefine it and retell that story and then really use the basis of what I thought was really brilliant from James is like using real names. So although the story is fictional, the names are real and these people existed. So, you know, it's educational as well as, you know, being entertaining.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, I was never a fan of Westerns because when I was a kid, we weren't allowed to watch them. I have an older sister who she was woke in the 70s. And she said, you're not gonna watch a movie about a group of white men committing genocide. She's like, that's not cool. We don't do that. And you know, Westerns are cool. Like I love Wyatt Earp's story, but there has to be a balance. You have to see the full spectrum to appreciate those movies. When it's only coming from one point of view, you know, that's why this is important. I don't think the effort of trying to redefine that. We didn't go in this thinking we're going to redefine a genre. But, I mean, I think it's important to show people that, you know, everybody existed. What about the other stories? What about what was happening during that's this right. time in China? So if you have the full spectrum, I think it would even give a larger appreciation for me from the Westerns that were told then, if I could see the other side. So that part is important to me, not the redefining of a genre. I mean,
one in four cowboys were black. Like there was literally hundreds of years of that experience with black people and people of color and women that at no point in the history have women ever been subservient. But because women weren't given, there was no like big women directors working in big budgets in Hollywood in the 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s. And there was no people of color working with big budgets to direct their own movies in those periods. So Hollywood was giving us a really narrow vantage point of their stories, which were really white male-centric stories. And I love those films. I still do. Because I believe if you take away a piece of history, you've literally had, now you have a domino effect that affects all of history. You can have the best car in the world. You can be driving a Bugatti, but take one of the wheels off. Then you've got the worst car that was ever created. And it affects all history. Imagine being Native American in America and all you know about your people is what Hollywood gave you in the Old West. Do you know there was never a time where Native Americans circled wagons with a white poor family in the middle of them, making that noise with the mouth. This stuff never, it just wasn't a thing. It's just myths perpetrated by Hollywood. And you know, what they were doing for them was entertaining at the time. But loving Westerns as I do, I just thought there's just so much more. So you end up, I believe, redefining the genre. For me, it's just obeying my crazy, right? Okay, this needs this type of music. This needs that, and they all, and everything speaks to each other. But at no point in Frank James or Jesse James's career did they ever hear a song that went, never, that's not cowboy music. We just take that as cowboy music then. So when I'm doing a Western now, I want to think, okay, what would be our version and our interpretation of that? It's time to unleash a whole new brand.
That's right.
Of what we regard as score on this thing. So in the end, you end up, I suppose, putting a cast of black people in it, doing something wholly new with the music, doing something wholly new with the men and women and their power and lack of subservience. You put all of these ingredients in, and I suppose it could be regarded as redefining a genre. But for me, at root, it isn't. It's just good old-fashioned storytelling. It's all about telling a story, and you want to tell a story to the best of the story's ability. And I wouldn't want to do a Western or shoot something that takes place in the Old West and retread an area that's already been tread. If it's already been tread, there's no reason for me to make it. So, that's my take on it.
I think it's the same way you approach, you know who's gonna play these parts. You know, you just go where people are really good at their craft. You know, we're students. You know, we just say, man, Cudi is amazing. Let's see if we can get him on a song. It really works like that. And then, you know, create these landscapes where you know they can fit into this story. You know, again, it's fun. We're working together. We're doing things that we love. We're really passionate about it. You know, it's not business for us. It's like trying to create things and create art that's gonna outlast us. And you know, I think that's all I got.
The difference between Jeymes Samuel and Jay-Z is Jay-Z has never bought a Jay-Z record. I have. I know what I buy. So when he gives me the verse of life, I just heard the verse of life. And then he'll go, it's not right. Nah, I'm just relaying a thought. I want the thought relayed and recorded. That's the thought. I know what I buy. I'm buying that too. But then you'll hit me like a week or so later. And you'd be like, that 17 with the switch. And he would. That's what happened with My Guns Go Bang.
Yeah.
When you heard the orchestra. And because I was just in the studio, we were recording the score. Orchestra, I turned the camera around and you started doing this. And you can actually see the words coming. I can't hear them. But you can see it coming. I was like, send it to me. And you put in 12 bars, just describe the entire story of the film. And before, I'd had just ideas you play with over the guns and this and that, and there were no visuals. And I just wish I wish FaceTime had record. So I could just, at least I could steal it. So working with Jay, I'm just in my own creative process, like, I'm used to, you just have to remain fluid. The fun thing with working with Jay, I mean, firstly, and you know, it's interesting because when I get asked questions about Jay's involvement in the film, a lot of times they're music centric and people automatically think it's music centric, but this man is like hugely cine literate. There's no area I go to creatively that he doesn't speak fluently. So a lot of it would be, we'll be talking about the film stuff and story stuff and this and that and the other. The music is like the icing on the cake. It'll be like this particular song, or I'll be writing the title track, The Harder They Fall, which is a dancehall record, right? Because we wanted to make a thing about dub and that being the underlying signature of the film. I'll be writing that, and then I'll call Jay. And you came up with a whole that Coffee sings on the soundtrack. The better we fall, our time is borrowed. Live like it's our last day. There is no tomorrow. It's all Jay. Like, he was on the phone, and you were like, you know, our time, because our time is actually borrowed. Our time is borrowed. Who's it borrowed from? and then you went into your Western bag, right? Mm-hmm. He's like, blowing like tumbleweed. Night come like thief. Till the rooster crows. Till the rooster, because the rooster does indeed crow. Till the rooster crows. So just it's literally, I always say it's like breathing. And then selecting the artist, as you said, is exactly like selecting the cast. But we ping pong, or tennis, as you say.
That's right.
We tennis music all the time.
So the alchemy of this combination is amazing, because you have to be so in tune visually and sonically. So when we first started, I said to James, what does this movie look like? Like, what does it look like? Is it dusty Western? And he showed me an image of a Kadir Nelson painting. Several, actually. And he said, this is the palette of the movie. I was like, wow, you see it colorful like that? So visually, we have to be in tune. Like, all of us have to, like, really imagine what it's going to look like. You know, that was a big thing. James says, I want Redwood to just be bright. And I want it to show the best of us and really colorful. And we were location scouting. It's like, none of these places are that. So we had to just imagine what it's going to look like. But, you know, it was challenging for me at first, because I had to get caught up just sonically what was in James's head. Because I'm seeing one thing. I know a couple times on set, I would say to James, I would just pull him aside and say, this is not going to work. Like, this scene's not going to cut together. It doesn't make sense. And he was like, trust me, I got it. And I was like, no, you don't. You don't. It's not. But he was working on two different levels. It was going to work because of the music that was going there. But he had it in his head to the point where we had a in Trudy Saloon. We were shooting the scene the next week, and everyone's saying, "What are we doing? What are we doing?" James hadn't written the song yet, and I'm like, "Do we need to change the schedule?" Because he doesn't have the song, and we have a singer flying in. He doesn't have the song. He went home and wrote the song that night, and it's one of the most beautiful songs in the movie. And I mean, you just have to be nimble and to be able to adapt. And with these guys, you have that. You just have to get going. And once we got up to speed, it really worked. But going into it, I can't imagine somebody being able to ping pong with James like that, to be able to just quickly get up to speed. Because several times it was like, yo, man, that don't make sense. Like, what are you doing? You know? Yeah.
For me, it's two things I want people to take away from this movie. The one takeaway is, just because you show black people in a period piece, it doesn't mean they were subservient or less than human, or people of color in a period piece. But it's almost commonplace that if we are telling a period piece story of involving black people, even in places where they weren't subservient,
that's right,
they'll be subservient in that story. Like, my frustration with Westerns is there'll always be some kind of reason why the black person is there, or reference, he was a slave owned by the Arnold Johnson plantation, just something. Or women in the Old West, where it's just as a genre in and of itself. I really wanted to make a purposeful point of actually deaden that narrative, like, stop it. if you make Open Range with Kevin Costner and Robert Duvall, you can have a black person in there. They're around in times. If you make, you know, I'm just saying, there doesn't have to be reference to subservience all the time. Secondly, you know, when we were kids, we used to sing scores all the time. So I really want people to come away from The Harder They Fall celebrating the score. We don't sing scores no more. It's almost as if, there's still great scores being made, but it's almost as if that was a thing of the past. And I really want people to watch The Harder They Fall and come away with like the motifs and the actual score. I use Barrington Levy's voice on the score. I use voices on the score in this movie. It's almost a seamless transition between score and songs. So that's a big thing I want people to come away from, and just getting us back to, you know, to celebrating the score again.
For me, it's like, you might like the comedy of Beckwith, you know, you might like the love story. Just, I just like when people feel something, and just when you leave the theater, I don't want our storytelling to tell somebody how to feel. I just want them to get emotion from it. It's like, how did it make you feel? And that's what I say to people, you know, mostly is not, did you like it? Like, how did it make you feel? You know, and that's all I ever want from storytelling.
I just say just possibilities. You know, narrow-minded stories get told, and then someone tells a story, and then it's like, oh, wow, I didn't know you could do that. I didn't know you could put that reggae against a Western. Things are easily defined, right? Western, reggae, pop. You know, if you listen to even some of the songs in the movie, where do you put a song? Where you put Guns Go Bang, right? It's, sure, there's rap on it, but the way Kid Cudi is singing these words that were written is just like, what am I listening to? You know, and you know, once that's done, the possibility, say, like, you know, when the first person ran like no one ran a 4 minute mile.
Wow. Yeah.
And then, like, once someone did it, 30 people did it in the month, right? So for me, the idea of like just creating these stories and these complex characters, and then people say to themselves, the next filmmakers or writers at home, like, wait a minute, you can do that? Okay, let me try to do this. And then you expand it. You expand it. Yeah.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.